afternoon, everyone. I'd like to spend like a few minutes to introduce you about C-STAR or Southeast Asia STAR Business Center. What is it and what do we do and why are we here? STAR is actually, Southeast Asia STAR Business Center is actually a an arm for the extensions of International STAR Secretariat. We are promoting a network of researchers on about the global change issue. Global change issue is not just the climate change, but it also covers other changes as well. Land use land cover change, something that we did in the past, social economic change, and many other changes that will affect the global context and might have the downstream effect on the local issues. We are not positioned as the institutions, research institute ourselves. A lot of people whom we had worked with in the past may have joined our research program, but our research program is actually an effort to develop the framework, frame of thought, methodologies, test the method of how to study the climate change and climate change adaptations. And we also used research program in the past to build capacity of researchers to extend their work outside their field to cover the climate change adaptation as well. So the main purpose of our mandate is to generate new knowledge through this research network of researchers. And we're also trying to do what we call knowledge sharing, whereby we try to synthesize research work and make it understandable to layman's people or non-academic peoples, and partly is to inform the policy about what should they do based on the knowledge that has been generated. We work primarily in Southeast Asia, and in the past we did work in like Laos, Cambodia, Vietnam. But recently our focus is only in Thailand, because half time of my time is working for Thailand Research Fund, whereby we use Thailand Research Fund mechanism to fund team of researchers on climate change adaptations, and trying to address the issue of climate change adaptation from multiple sector, multiple scale, and multiple threat assessment. And we're trying to introduce the concept of holistic assessment and mainstream climate change adaptations into policy and plan. We do not foresee climate change adaptation policy itself as the... It doesn't have to be a separate plan. It would mean that we mainstream issue of climate change into water management strategy of the countries, or transportation plan of the countries, or community development plans, or whatsoever, or even city planning to make it resilient to the future changes. So this is about C-STAR and what STAR and C-STAR. In C-STAR, all located in actually is a part of, how to say, it's formed by International STAR Secretariat and Philanthropon University with collaboration through the NRCT National Research Council of Thailand. So we are actually part of the university itself, the Philanthropon University in Bangkok. So I will get into the main part of my presentation, which is about understanding climate change, risk and vulnerabilities. I believe that this term is well familiar by many of us, and since I heard this morning when you introduced yourself, some of you have already worked on the climate change vulnerabilities, some work with climate change adaptations. But in many cases, in my experience, I see that there are some confusing things or some misinterpretations about the climate change adaptation. So I hope that this presentation would help you reshape or, if necessary, reshape or alter the work that you are doing to fit in a proper context of climate change adaptations. So I intend to spend like 45 minutes, but I think I try to finish this presentation within half an hour, 35 minutes, so we can have time to exchange the idea or questions a bit, and try to keep my time precisely. Okay, this is 5 to 2. So introduction to climate change, we covered what, where, what, when, and where. What do we, when we talk about climate change, has a specific context of what, when, and where. And like I said before, I've seen a lot of misconceptions about the climate change, and I'd like to highlight them to alert that what, how shall we look at the climate change. And there are multiple of change when we talk about climate change. It's not just plus 1, plus 2, plus 3 degrees Celsius always. But there are many dimensions of change. I'll give you some example about the future change. So you have an idea about what kind of trend of climate change you can expect in the Southeast Asia. Then I will touch slightly on the vulnerability, just to give you the context of what is vulnerability. Vulnerability is a term that has been used very broadly and in many cases very confusingly. So I just touched about the concept and the idea about what is vulnerability and about the climate change adaptation as well, just to give you an idea about when we talk about climate change adaptation, what is it, what does it mean, and why do we have to do it? Because I believe that over the next few days, you have to visit these terms, the vulnerabilities and adaptations a lot, and it will be further elaborated by Patrick and Nathan, and some other people in the team. So what is climate change? Climate change is actually the change in climate pattern, and I have to emphasize this climate pattern. What is climate pattern? And when we talk about when, it's about future always. Global warming is something that will get more severe in the future as we, when you have a more severe greenhouse effect due to the burning or consumption of fossil fuel. Fossil fuel is actually hydrocarbon, and then we burn it or using mostly internal combustion engine or whatever. When we burn it, the molecule break, and then we get CO2, and this CO2 is the main part of the greenhouse gas, and it will accumulate in the atmosphere, and it will trap the energies from the sun. The energy from the sun, when it reach the surface of the earth, it will reflect as a long wave radiations, and it will, if we don't have a severe greenhouse gas or large amount of greenhouse gas in the atmosphere, part of the energy will release back to the space. But when we have thicker and more concentrated greenhouse gas, it will trap the energies and it will warm up the atmosphere. So we're looking into the future. A lot of people think of climate change as changing climate. So, but it's not the same. We are looking into the future as our society consumes more and more fuel, fossil fuel. Greenhouse gas is expected to rise in the future by a lot. This is this chart shows you the scenarios of how greenhouse gas may increase due to the different pathway of development. So we, if we develop in a very high energy consumption, greenhouse gas may increase very rapidly and by magnitude of a lot. However, if we, our world economy develop into a more carbon footprint, or we can sustain our society based on renewable energy in the higher ratios, greenhouse gas may not rise as much. So these are the different scenarios. And different scenarios bring different efficiencies. This chart, this picture shows you that in over the next 10, 30 years, the world may be warming up by a little bit, but as we move along into the new generations, the next few generations, the world will be warming up by a lot. I've seen some simulation whereby somewhere in the late of this century, there'll be no ice in the ice cap in the North Pole at all, at least in the summertime. This shows that the world, the surface of the Earth is warming up, but it's not warming up uniformly across the surface of the Earth, because we have landform, we have ocean, we have different type of land cover, we have forest, we have desert. So it's not warming up in a uniform manner. So this difference in temperatures, surface temperature, it will disturb the wind, and it will evaporate. The ocean will evaporate even more than today. The rain that precipitation on the land is actually mostly the moisture that we receive from the oceans. And when the wind change direction or speed or directions, it will affect the drought or even flood, because we may have higher precipitation in some areas, we may have less precipitation in some areas. The wind may blow into some other part. Higher evaporations in the very, very inland landform would mean that it will be even more drought, because higher evaporations and less rainfall. So these are the climate that may change in the future due to the global warming, as it's not warming up even uniformly. However, the climate, changing climate pattern may not be may not caused by the global effect, global warming effect alone. There are also some other factors that influence our climate pattern, particularly the sea surface anomaly. Some of you may, I think most of you may familiar with the terms, and so or El Nino, Southern Oscillations, whereby the it's anomaly of the sea surface temperature in the Pacific Oceans. And in some years, in a normal condition, we have a warm pool around this area, but in El Nino year, the warm pool spread across the oceans. Or in La Nina year, the warm pool is moving towards Asian side. And it will cause, it will interrupt the weather patterns. And when we look into the climate variations over the years, over the long period of time, we have the climate characteristic that we may have a high cycle of the La Nina year, and we may have a high cycle of El Nino year. So this will affect the pattern of the rainfall, and the chart above shows you the rainfall normally in Thailand over the past, let's say, half centuries or so. So if we look at this chart and we plot graph, we may see change in the trend of precipitation, but it's not the climate change due to global warming effect. It's actually the big cycle of the ENSO itself. So we have to take into consideration that it's not, the changing in the past may not be part of the global warming effect, but it's probably part of the sea surface cycle of sea surface anomalies, sea surface temperature anomalies. And in addition to the ENSO, we also have the same phenomenon in the Indian Ocean as well, whereby we have the warm pool of water in the Asia side or in the Africa side, and that will affect the southwest monsoon, and it will affect the rainfall in our countries in Southern Asia as well. So these are the factors that will influence our climate system. But when we talk about the climate change, we focus only on to the change in climate pattern due to the rising of greenhouse gas in atmospheric systems and the global warming effects. There are a lot of confusing over the years that I've been experienced. A lot of people confused about this term, climate, weather, and extreme event. What is climate? In English, we have the word climate and weather, but in Thai or in even some of our Southeast Asian language, we don't have two different words to use for climate and weather. It even creates more confusion about this. Climate is actually the summarized of the weather characteristic over the long, long period of time. In meteorology, we use like 30 years period to summarize character of the weather and form a climate. Weather is something that we can expect, we can forecast, but climate is something that we cannot forecast. It's something that we see the shift and change in the long term. What is extreme weather event? Extreme weather event is mean the big anomaly of weather. For example, like we may have storms, we may have very hot year, we may have very dry year, we may have very cold year or very warm year. But extreme weather events mean event-based. It could mean something that happened in a year. Flood in 2011, that very severe flood, that's an extreme event. But is it climate or is it climate change? No, it's an extreme event. But when we talk about extreme event in the context of climate, we may have to look at the frequency and magnitude of such extreme event over the period of time. For example, like the largest flood in 30 years' time is about this. Or we have flood of this magnitude, like once in 10 years, once in 15 years, something like that. That's how we address extreme weather events or disaster, climate-related disaster in the context of climate. But we are not talking of particular event over the year. This is very important because when we get down to how to respond to this, we will have the climate change adaptation and we will have disaster risk reductions. These two are not the same. They overlap in to some degree, but they are not the same. A lot of people mistaken disaster risk reduction as climate change adaptations. And we have this climate change and climate variability. Climate is not uniform across time. We don't have the same rainfall every year. We have dry year, we have wet year, but when we talk about these fluctuations, it's a climate variability. But if we talk about change in the pattern of rainfall of this 30 years time and this 30 years time, that's the climate change. And when we come down to the consequence of such climate change, we have terms like climate threat or pressures, the impact of climate change, climate risk and vulnerabilities, they're also not the same. When we talk about threat, it means some climate characteristic or parameters that have pressures or threaten our well-being or livelihood or productivities or whatsoever that will have negative impact on our life. The impact itself is a consequence of the threat. For example, like the threat would mean higher precipitation or very severe, very intense precipitation over a month of XYZ. And it creates flood. Flood is the impact of such climate anomalies. And the risk means people who are facing such conditions, people facing with such flood. And if they cannot cope with that, it means they are vulnerable. But be careful, this term sometimes they use in very mixed context and of context. So like I said before, when we talk about climate change, it's a mix-up between climate change and biodiversity. And when we look at climate change in any news media or whatsoever, we often see that it overly emphasizes the global mean temperatures. You can see a lot of articles talking about the world with plus 4 degrees C. But plus 4 degrees plus 4 degrees C means it's like a simplified terms to illustrate that, to demonstrate that the world is warming up, but it's not that we plus 4 degrees onto every day. And when we talk about means, we overlook the change that cannot be represented by means change. For example, like if you look at the hot year or the dry year and wet year, if they are changing in two directions and we average them, we don't see a change in the means. For example, like this pictures. Dry year could be very dry and wet year could be very wet. And when we look at the precipitation over a period of time, we don't see change in the means, but actually a change in the pattern. But means could also change due to change in maximum and minimum temperature or precipitations. And then the average that we see change in the means, but no change in means temperature or no change in mean precipitation doesn't mean that there's no change in climate patterns. So when we look at climate change, it's not just about the global means or average temperature, average rainfall, but we have to look into multiple dimensions of climate change because different sector, different system, or different individuals may have different concerns or different change. So we may have to look into the magnitude of change. We may have to look into the frequency of, for example, like return cycle or extreme events. 1 in 20 year flood or 1 in 20 year drought could be 1 in 20 year. Or not. That means change in terms of frequency. And by the magnitude, we have like 2 meter flood. Will it change into 3 meter flood or not? That's a change in weather patterns or change in the impact of climate. Or we may have like, I just wrong example. We have like, the wet year could mean 2000 millimeters precipitation per year. But in the future, it could mean 3,000 millimeter per year or not. That's something change in the magnitude of weather patterns. Or we may have to look at change in terms of distributions over space and time. Like I said, it's not uniformly changed across the surface of the Earth. It's not changed, but it doesn't change uniformly across the surface of the country as well. So we may have the area that wasn't very hot, become very, very hot. It could be like distribution of weather parameters over the geographical areas. Different watershed may have different province, different watershed may have different climate pattern in the future. And also change in terms of time, space and time. It's not only space, but also time. For example, like length of the seasons. We may have 3 months for rainy seasons, but in the future it could be 4 months or not. Or our winter could cover the period of December to February, but in the future it could shorten by a month or two. So it means shorter winter time is also changed in terms of time. It could mean change in the onset of the season. We used to have rainy season start from May, but would it shift to June, will it shift to July or not? That will change in terms of time. The tropical storms that used to come in October, it's probably coming into November time, for example. So these are the shift and change in various aspects. Magnitude, frequency, distributions across space and time. So So if you look at climate change, we have to contextualize it properly. This is an example. When we look at average maximum temperatures, we see change in one pattern because we average the maximum temperatures. But if we take hottest day of the year or hottest day of the decade and plot it, we have different pictures, we have different concerns. So in some cases, for example, like when we look at impact of climate change on biodiversity, some species have a certain tolerance. If that day, if the maximum temperature of that day exceeds 40 degrees, it dies really. So it doesn't matter what the rest of the year the climate would be, right? For example, cross space and time, these two set of pictures show you that the change in average maximum temperature, the area that wasn't very hot might become very, very hot. And it's not only warmer, but the summer will also extend longer. So we will count the hot period over the year, we'll see the change. For example, like in Central or in Cambodia, it's showing. Like in Central Plain of Chao Phraya River in Thailand, we may have summertime for like 3-4 months. But in the future, the summer may extend into something like 5 to 6 months. And that could mean a lot of impact and a lot of risk to many systems and many sectors. So the climate change consequence of global warming, we can observe the past, but how can we tell the future? It's a slow and complex process. So and it looks into very, very far futures. We cannot forecast it, but we can project it. And normally we simulate the climate based on using the change in the future greenhouse gas concentrations, put it into a model, and we simulate future climate scenarios. And this is one of the examples that we have simulated for Southeast Asia. This is the average daily maximum temperature, daytime temperature, put it in a common terms. It's a daytime temperature. You see that it tend to change particularly over the during the second half of the centuries. And this is the hottest day of the year in the future. Now when we have any days that we get weather report that the temperature is over 40, we get very, very alert and very the news. It becomes news in the newspaper almost every time. But in the future, it may be a common phenomenon, and to become a news, it may have to be exceeding 45, something like that. So we'll see that the hottest day of the year will get even warmer. And it's not only warmer, the hot period of the year will also extend longer. And on the other side, this winter time or the cold period will also shorten. So shorten, shift and change in seasonal, shift and change in the magnitude of the climate patterns, shift and change in seasonal patterns will also affect a lot, but what change and what affect to what? We have to put it into very, very specific context. And we may have higher precipitations in the regions, especially the second half of the centuries. One of the reasons is that we are at the rim of the continent. And then we have a stronger monsoon and higher precipitation and higher evaporation from the oceans. The moisture from the ocean will flow into the land and we'll have a higher precipitation. And one of the analysis showed that we have higher precipitation, but the rainy season doesn't extend longer. So we'll have a more intense rainy season in the future. That's the trend. And that would mean higher risk from the landslide, higher risk from flood, because it's more intense. 10% higher precipitation doesn't mean 10% higher risk of flood, because to a certain extent, the soil moisture may reach it critical. So additional 10% of rain will be a net increase in the river channels. So the flood could mean given birth. So at a glance, what do we see the climate change, Southeast Asia, and put it in very short time, short words, warmer and wetter, that could mean our future, 1-2 generations from now. It tends to be slightly warmer, but hot area will extend, will wide. Longer summertime, extend into the future, and higher precipitation, very, 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 very bad rainy seasons. And that is something that I extract from IPCC Assessment Report 4. Assessment Report 5 also come up with similar conclusions that we may have longer, warmer summertime, we may have shorter and warmer winter time, and higher precipitation in the rainy seasons. There are many, many forecasts. There are not many, many projections, future climate projection that you can review, but I would like to alert that for those of you who may use future climate projections as part of your studies, these are scenarios. They are not super, super, super long-range weather forecast. A lot of people use this as a weather forecast, but it's a climate scenario. It's not weather forecast. It only shows plausible futures, and it has to be used in the context of climate. These data are generated using the weather generators. So we have very detailed data, like in daily or even hourly data. But we can't use that. We have to summarize that into a climate characteristic. So use this data set as a climate, not weather. And it doesn't represent truth. It only shows a very clear future under a set of assumptions. It's not a forecast. It's not the truth. It's one plausible future only. And it's never perfect. You can't wait for the perfect information to arise. Also uncertainty, we don't know whether it will happen or not, so we may have to rely our study based on multiple scenarios. And there'll be new and improved method coming, but we can't wait. If you wait, it will be like chasing a shadow. You will never come up with the best scenario at all. Some of the frequently asked questions that I have been asked when I present this future climate prediction is that which scenario is this, or which one is the most likely. I think these are irrelevant because scenario doesn't represent the future truth anyway. So we have to think about how to, when we want to use this future climate prediction to support our study or be part of our studies, we have to think which one is the riskiest, which one is the hottest, which one is the coldest, which one is the wettest. It depends on the problem that you want to solve. If you want to solve flood problems or you want to find adaptation to future flood, you may have to pick the better scenario to represent the worst case scenario. Or use different scenario to do stress test to something that you are coping with the situation and see whether you pass all of them or not. If not, what conditions does the option fail, and then we find adaptations to that. So I think I spent like 30 minutes already, but it spent another 5. We're talking about this climate change and vulnerabilities. So when we think about vulnerability, I see many, many, many cases that use the term vulnerability in a very abstract way. But when we want to do vulnerability assessment, we have to be very, very specific about the context. Whose vulnerability are we talking about? The system, the sector, the agriculture or subsector like rice farming, blah, blah, blah. Or demographic groups, the young, the old, the man, the boy, the woman. Geographic groups, people who live by the sea, people who live by the river, people who live in the mountain, or even household or individuals. But whose vulnerability are we talking about and where? That will determine the context of what is the climate that we should look for. because different these people or this different group of social economic groups will be sensitive to different climate parameters. So without being certain about who are we trying to assess, will be get very blurred or very confused when we try to look at the future climate change and determine the risk, because it could be change in the frequency and magnitude of flood, it could be change in the seasonal pattern, it could be change in the extreme, change in the onset of the season, something like that. Here's something that I like to show. Some sector may be different affected, but some may be affected by the chain of consequence, the change. For example, like if we have a stronger monsoon, stronger monsoon means change in wind speed and wind directions. Some sector like fishermen cannot go out to sea, that's a direct impact of climate change to their livelihood. But to coastal settlement, stronger monsoon could mean stronger wave and sea level rise. It could mean more severe coastal erosions, and then it will threaten their settlement. So we have to think about this. It's not a direct impact of climate change always. It may be a consequence of the impact of climate change that will threaten our livelihood, and that will dictate how we should adapt to that. And vulnerabilities. What is it? Vulnerabilities. A lot of people take vulnerabilities as a very, in a very abstract way as well. This polar bear look vulnerable to me, but what is vulnerability actually? There are many definitions, and this is the one that I like. It's, to put it in a common terms, vulnerability means fragile, like a glass. And when I put, the glass is very sensitive to the impact. If I drop it, it breaks. This is sensitivity. When you think about this. And if I put the glass at the edge of the table, it exposed to being dropped. And this glass doesn't have, it's not very strong, so if you draw it, break. So it doesn't have any coping glass at all. So if I put a glass like this, it's very vulnerable situations for this glass. But if I put it far away, then it will be less exposed to being dropped. Or another example is that my house, your house, we live next to the river, we have same exposure to flood because we live side by side by the river front. But if my house is built on stilt and it's not built on the ground, I'm less sensitive to flood. 1 meter flood, I can still live in my house, but 1 meter flood, he has to move out and live with his friends somewhere else. And if he has insurance or he has saving, after flood is gone, he can repair. Or if his house is built properly, once the flood is gone, it could mean he can come back and live in that same house in very, very short time. That's meaning his house is capable to cope with, or has coping capacity to the flood risk. So vulnerability has to have a very, very specific context. Who's vulnerability to what risk? We can't use vulnerability of blah, blah, to climate change, but what is climate change? Vulnerability of the farmers in central plain of Chao Phraya to extend dry spell period, and that's something that we have to put into context. So we have who and what to look at. So we have to put very, very specific context as if this. And this is how I look at the climate change vulnerability and adaptations. There are a lot of studies that take climate change as the initial point in the assessment. We try to look into what will happen or what may happen in 50 years from now, and try to find the impact and try to find adaptations to that impact. But some of those studies has overlooked the social dynamics. And And addressing to adaptation means trying to preserve status quo today, which always not the case. I don't think we live the same way we lived 50 years ago. And I don't think that the kids two generations from now will live the same way as we do. So we have to take into consideration the social and economic dynamic into the picture. So in the trend of looking at vulnerability and climate change and climate change adaptation, we may have to start from the concern of today, how the system is at risk, from what pressure, and what does it bring to this sector. Shorter rainy season could mean longer tourist seasons, but it means less water for agriculture. Stronger monsoon season mean coastal community has to, they cannot go out to sea to do fishing. They have to rely on coastal ecosystem, like finding the clam on the beach or something like that. But sea level rise may affect, may contaminate the aquifers, and these people on the coastal village has to rely on the well, water from well. So if it contaminated with sea level, sea water, it means they have no water for consumption. But we can't take the climate change as the only factor that pressures the society. We may have to look into social economic change as well. For example, we have a very, very big tourist promotion program for like maybe a decade too. So we have a high number of tourists over the past 10 years, like double. And we have the biofuel promotion. And that means more tourists, more palm oil plantation, and that means high water demand for these two sectors. It would mean that they draw the water from the river stream and less water, fresh water, to support coastal ecosystem. And at the end of the day, this coastal community under two pressures from the climate and non-climate, and also effect of other sectors that respond to the climate change, may not sustain their livelihood, and they may have to migrate into urban. So different aspects of climate change adaptation mean we need to reduce vulnerability, or how we reduce exposure. For example, like if I place the glass like that, it's very vulnerable to breaking from dropping. We move it inside, like relocate the communities, something like that. Less exposed, or less sensitivities that we may have to think about, or increase the coping capacity. I won't go into very detail, but to plan for climate change adaptation, these are something that we need to talk about. Strategic thinking. It's not detailed action. We have to think strategically first, and then find the way to drive the strategies. But strategy should be turned left or should be turned right. We have to think about that. And if we turn left, then should we ride a horse, should we ride a car, should we walk, should we run? That's how we get from A to B. And it's about risk management. We have to think about that. Why do we adapt? Because we are at risk. People doesn't adapt to climate change. People adapt to risk that arise from climate change. And this is something that I think our society doesn't really aware of. And I think everybody in this room, to a certain extent, understand climate change. But may I ask, what does it mean to you? And why you should adapt? Because you're not aware of the risk or the consequence of the climate change. And I think this is one of the big gaps in our society. And when we talk about climate change adaptation, we think about resilience of the society or the robustness of the policy and plan. The policy and plan should still function and achieve its goals under future conditions. And if it's not, then we have to find a new way to drive that strategies and plan, to make it more robust, and it could mean different development pathway. We talk about social transformations. It's not that climate change may reduce productivity of rice production by 10%, and adapting to climate change means we have to increase it back to 100%. It could mean that it is not feasible to do rice farming here anymore. should we do something else to achieve a change livelihood altogether? So that's strategic thinking, and I think I leave this. So in summary, we think we should think about climate change from various aspects to make it to cover. To it doesn't have to be a response to the climate change itself, but it means that we need a new strategy and directions to make our society more resilient, and that could mean alternate actions or alternate pathway of development, alternate action to implement strategies or new initiatives to manage the risk. There are multiple levels of climate change adaptations. It could mean household, it could mean community, province, national, regions. And in most cases, we can't put household together to make a community. We can't put community together to make provincials. Adaptation plan for provincial have to have its own context, have to have its own framework to plan. Adaptations at community, as household, they are different concepts, different way of thinking altogether, and we have to think about that when we plan for climate change adaptation planning studies. Also, multiple approach of adaptation, something that you can do alone, individual, something that you need to do in collective way. Multiple method of climate change adaptation, it doesn't mean engineering solution always. A lot of people think about engineering solutions, flood, you will die, problem gone, but not necessary. It could mean social, livelihood, economic aspect, it could be institutional aspect, it could be many other things. Be creative about how to manage the risk. It doesn't have to be engineering solution always. Thank you.